At the outset, I'd like to thank Chaitanya Eye Hospital and Research Institute for having me here this morning, and especially Dr. Sapna Nair for being nice enough to get me over here. And so I'll be talking about ophthalmic visco-surgical devices, and I'll touch upon something known as the soft shell technique. I would like to state that I have no financial interest in any of the products, procedures, or instrumentation mentioned in the presentation. OVDs are also called commonly in common parlance viscoelastics. That's what we'll call in the OT, and that is what our OT staff would usually understand. So these are used to protect tissue from mechanical damage, provide a space for surgical manipulation, and manipulate tissues. And they help us maintain the chamber, as KP just mentioned. They protect the endothelium during phacoemulsification, and they open the capsular bag during IOL implantation. Viscoelastics play a key role in surgical outcomes. The attributes, so what is an ideal OVD? It should protect the corneal endothelium, which is of primary importance. It should provide a well-formed anterior chamber for various steps, and also protect the posterior capsule during that procedure. It should be retained during the process, or during the time that we are doing the phacoemulsification. The material should be reasonably clear. It should be easily removable, which is a major problem that we have, because it takes up quite a bit of time, and I think the reason why some people prefer doing it under hydro. And it should have little effect on IOP. So these are the attributes of an ideal OVD. Unfortunately, an ideal OVD does not exist as yet. So what are the types of viscoelastics? There's a lot of confusion. Some of us who've grown up with this, we sort of understand how they evolved, but for the newer residents, it might be very confusing. Broadly speaking, they are cohesive and dispersive. There are some other terminologies that have come in, and cohesive are high molecular weight viscoelastics with high pseudoplasticity, I'll talk about these terms, and high surface tension. Essentially, they have entangling molecules that cling to themselves. If you remember your bit of physics from school, cohesive is a substance which sticks together, adhesive is which sticks to the other body. And then the other variety is the dispersive. They have low to medium molecular weight, low pseudoplasticity, and low surface tension. And the tendency of these viscoelastic solutions is to spread, because they have essentially non-entangling molecules that break apart. So coming to dispersive OVDs, they provide longer lasting coating of tissues, especially the endothelium, and they by dispersion, and they have low surface tension. And Viscoat, again no financial interest, is a product which has a triple negative charge, and higher the negative charge, higher the cohesiveness. Isolates tissues and trouble areas in cases of zonular dialysis and posterior capsular rents. I'll touch upon this again. And it partitions space, providing a working space for phacoemulsification under the layer of viscoat on the cornea, and stays in place to resist positive pressure, positive vitreous pressure, and flattens the dome surface during capsular excess. Cohesives maintain the chamber well during capsular excess. This is a very important property they have. They separate them and manipulate the tissues, as example in adhesions and small pupils. If you have small pupil, you push in a cohesive, it will dilate it to some extent, and expands the capsular bag very well, very easily removable. When you do an irrigation aspiration, it comes out like a blob. And that is what I think we can use if we want, during IOL implantation, if we want the viscoelastic to come out and we don't want to spend too much time and that should not be retained. Unfortunately, most of these are comparatively expensive, and it has very good optical clarity. So again, now the subtypes, there are the dispersives, example is Viscoat and a very good old HPMC, which most of us are using. Cohesives like Provisc, Helon is the most commonly known. They're essentially sodium hyaluronate. Viscous dispersive is like Discovisc, and highly cohesive ones, which are, or viscoadaptive as they're also called, are the Helon GV and Helon 5. So just to highlight the difference between these two, I'll just show you a video, a very old video many of you would have seen. So this is the cohesive. You see how it's holding on together, and dispersive, it's spreading out. And when you wash it with water, when water goes, it comes out like a blob, the cohesive one, and the dispersive tends to stick. So the dividing line between cohesive and dispersive viscoelastic lies at about 1 million Daltons. Greater than 1 million is cohesive, and lesser, broadly speaking, lesser than 1 million is dispersive. These are the various types, Helon GV, Helon 5, you see they are more than 1000. Viscoat and OcuCoat, which is HPMC essentially, is below this. So what is pseudoplasticity? In these, viscosity is highest when the substance is undisturbed, is very viscous, and subjected to little or no stress, that is low shear rate. But as soon as you apply pressure or shear, one example is when you have a syringe filled with this and you're pushing it, that's shear being applied. It drops as shear rate increases. And this behavior is called seroplasticity. That means the viscosity decreases on a application of pressure or shear. That's called seroplasticity. Cohesive products have high seroplasticity. They start off very viscous at rest. You saw that lying there. But when you apply stress, they lose viscosity rapidly. Dispersive products, on the other hand, they have low seroplasticity. They start off with moderate or low viscosity at rest, but lose viscosity gradually under stress. Even HPMC, you may have noticed that, even viscote for that matter, you have to apply a lot more pressure once it starts moving. Elasticity is the tendency of a physical body to return to its original shape after having been stretched, compressed, or deformed. This is all from our physics, school physics. And cohesive products with high resting velocity have greater elasticity, and dispersive products have medium elasticity. Surface tension is another important physical property. Cohesive products have high surface tension. They tend to bead up, as you saw in that video. Dispersive products have low surface tension, so they tend to spread out and coat. And this is why we use this property to coat the endothelium. And molecular charge, as I mentioned, the more number of charges, the greater the attraction to surfaces. So these are some of the commonly used viscoelastics, like, and their composition. Helon GV is a 1.4% sodium hyaluronate. Helon is 1%. Viscote is 3% sodium hyaluronate plus a combination with 4% chondroitin sulfate. Chondroitin sulfate essentially has the property to adhere and stick to the endothelium. So all viscoelastics except viscote have a single negative charge. Viscote has a triple negative charge. In summary, dispersives have low molecular weight, short chains do not entangle, shorter chains take longer time to remove. They have medium elasticity, medium viscosity at low shear rates. HPMC products have the lowest viscosity at all shear levels, and they have low surface tension. Cohesive viscoelastics have high molecular weight, entangled chains are easy to remove because they come out like a blob, high elasticity, they have high viscosity at low shear rates, and this is basically high seroplasticity. And super cohesive products like Helon GV have the highest viscosity at low shear rates, and they have high surface tension. So what is best now coming, this is physics apart and understanding. So when we come to specific procedures and steps, what is best for capsular excess? In general, a cohesive viscoelastic would be better for capsular excess. And however, if the cohesive viscoelastic, there's a word of caution here, escapes, because you see the problem is that if you give it an opening, it'll escape. If it escapes during excess, its elasticity and high seroplasticity, which we want to use, will not be of much benefit. So the important thing is you have to maintain, you have to learn basically when we are beginning out and we depress the lower lip of the wound, and the viscoelastic tends to escape. So we don't want that situation. So if you can hold it in there, it will provide better capsular excess. For endothelial protection, dispersives, can I have a minute more? Minute or two? For endothelial protection, dispersives containing chondroitin sulfate, example, viscote are better. And in special situations, for using chondroitin sulfate based dispersive, like poor corneal endothelial status, like Gattata and early Fuchs dystrophy, it coats and improves the situation. Helps us tide over a difficult surgery. Posterior capsular rents, it can plug a small rent or control the rent. When we have a rent, we just immediately push in some viscote and will prevent the rent from increasing until the time that anterior vitrectomy is organized. There's a whole lot of science here that you don't pull out the irrigation fluid. With another hand, you push in, but that's for another speaker, I suppose. And subluxated cataracts, viscote layering as we call it, is used to separate the viscous vitreous. You layer it in the area of the subluxated zonules and compartmentalize. Basically, vitreous is behind, and then the irrigating fluid, you can continue with irrigation also at times and get away with it. And it prevents the mixing. As you know, when vitreous mixes with water, it tends to flow out. And in cases of floppy iris or chaffed iris also, we can use it to advantage. So this viscote is a dispersive, spreads fast, remains inside the eye for the entire procedure, coats the entire cornea and protects the endothelial cells. I've already talked about the properties. And so now the soft shell technique. A lot has been said about the soft shell technique. Essentially, it's a combination of different types of viscoelastics and OVDs basically to gain certain advantages. Problem is, most of these are expensive, and a combination in a country like ours, and all of us have gotten so used to using the good old HPMC. Sometimes I feel that talking about soft shell is probably not right, but you need to know. And again, there's a lot of confusion. There's a soft shell, there's an ultimate soft shell, then there's a tri soft shell. Essentially, I'll tell you what I do. I'll just show you what soft shell implies, and then I'll tell you what I do, which helps me. there's a video here. Basically what you do is, initially you put in a visco, a dispersive like a viscoat. The idea being that we eventually push it towards the endothelium to coat the endothelium and protect them from damage. And then a cohesive is pushed inside, which forms a blob, and it is pushing the the dispersive against the endothelium. So this is providing a shell where you can then do a rexis and do phacoemulsification. The reverse can be done during the phase of IL implantation, where cohesive is coating against the endothelium, and then BSS or ringer lactate, whatever you use, can be spread over here in the capsular bag, fills the capsular bag, and the lens can be implanted. So here, as I said, so the cohesives usually mentioned in these studies were essentially Helon, Helon GV, and I felt that using Viscoat 1 and Helon GV can be a very expensive combination. So what I normally do is, I would, for patients who need some corneal endothelium, I'm essentially a cornea surgeon, we need corneal protection, endothelial protection, I would use a Viscoat, and then I would use HPMC to push that Viscoat against the endothelium. And then the other advantage it offers me is that Viscoat, when you push in Viscoat, you may have seen that doing a rexis can be quite tedious. There's a lot of resistance to movement. So when you push in a HPMC under that, it's a less viscous substance. You can easily do an HPMC, and it can also save costs. So I think this also essentially is a variation of soft shell technique, but this works very well in for us. It reduces the cost also and provides the same benefits. So in posterior capsular rent, as I mentioned, it helps to plug a small rent. And however, whenever in doubt, you should go ahead with anterior vitrectomy. It is more useful in controlling the rent or extension or increase of size, and very often allows the in-bag implantation after anterior vitrectomy. In posterior capsular rent, I think I'll skip the video in the interest of time. So this was a diagrammatic representation. So there's an area of rent over here. This is Viscoat being used to plug it. So sometimes the procedure has been completed, and at the last minute there's a rent, you can just push in. You can place the lens, but more often than not, there would be some pieces, and it's always advisable to do an anterior vitrectomy and not again just put in the lens, because that can be a problem at times. In zonular dialysis, Viscoat layering can be done. We layer Viscoat in the area of dialysis, can prevent vitreous prolapse by segregating vitreous and irrigating fluids, and it often allows surgery to proceed uneventfully. Should I show the video? Just a little 15-second clip. I'll just take it to the... So you see there's an area of dialysis. Right in the end, I noticed there's a dialysis. Actually, the capsular edge got pulled in by the irrigating aspirating, during irrigation aspiration, and created a zonular dialysis over here. Now I knew that I would need to put in the lens, do some irrigation aspiration. So I'm just putting again some Viscoat over here, and then of course proceeded with the surgery and managed to finish the case. I put in a CTR ring also, I'm not showing that here, and then completed the surgery. So in conclusion, viscoelastics are an integral part of modern cataract surgery. Understanding the properties is important for the optimal use. Thank you for a patient hearing.